पेट्रोल डीजल ये हर महंगाई का आत्मा है। पेट्रोल डीजल का भाव बढ़ गया है तो हर तरह महंगाई बढ़ने वाली है।
गैस का भाव कितना है? 1000 रुपया। अभी 1000 रुपये में से हम लोग कितना ही गैस को ही डालेंगे तो खाएंगे क्या? गैस का भाव बढ़ रहा है ना, ये गलत है। अच्छे दिन नहीं आए, बुरे दिन आ गए।
तो 15 दिन हो गया सर, 1 रुपये का धंधा नहीं हुआ। अब मैं कहाँ से पढ़ा पाएगा, कहाँ से लिखा पाएगा? जितना मेरा लड़ रहा है ताकत उतना लड़ा रहा हूँ।
Prices are now a nightmare because where I used to spend maybe 2,000 rupees a year ago to fill a tank, now I'm spending almost 3,000 rupees to fill my tank.
At least half of my pocket money goes in petrol because it's like 10 kilometers up and down, and so it's affecting me a lot.
Well, a couple of stories that have emerged today. What you're looking at are visuals of fisher folk. Fishermen in Rameswaram in Tamil Nadu have gone on an indefinite strike against the diesel prices. Yesterday, we saw farmers who marched on Delhi. One of their demands was to bring down the diesel prices that were affecting them drastically. For people who run homes, gas cylinders now closing in on 900 rupees. School buses, transporters, truck drivers, auto drivers, even those now who use CNG, where CNG inches closer and closer to 50 rupees. It seems like it's hitting each and every one of us. We're opening up the phone lines today to answer as many questions as we can. Syed Zafar Aslam of the BJP has been kind enough to join us on the show and answer the questions. We also have with us tonight Gautam Mukherjee, senior journalist, Abhimanyu Kohar, national coordinator for the Rashtriya Kisan Mahasangh, Kavita Ashok is a citizen voice, Rajendra Kapoor is the president of the Delhi Goods and Transport Organization, and Professor Aman Agarwal, director for the Indian Institute of Finance, is an economist. I welcome all of you to this conversation. Opening statements from everyone. I'll start with Kavita Ashok. Kavita Ashok, when was the last time you bought a gas cylinder, and what does it cost? And how does that make you feel?
Well, I just feel a little fooled because I was very happy about the Ujwala scheme when it came in. I even gave away my, subsidy. But now that when I buy a cylinder, I just don't understand what hit me, basically. So it's more than ever, it's really skyrocketed, the price.
And Kavita Ashok, there is the need right now for, diesel, petrol prices, the effect it has on milk, the effect it has on the household budget, school bus prices as well. What sort of impact is it having on you as a citizen?
Price rise is it's like a chain effect, right? It affects everything from all the vegetables that we buy, as you just mentioned, school buses, the fee, the transportation. So it's not just one element which is being affected, it's a chain reaction. So I totally feel that if the salary is limited, if the salaries have not been given a raise, obviously, and the common man is being affected adversely. So when the salary is not rising and everything else is being high, fuel, onions, vegetables, the bus fees and so many other, miscellaneous things. I'm sure the common man is being hit very, very adversely.
Right. I want opening statements from all of my guests at this point. Abhimanyu Kohar is the national coordinator of the Rashtriya Kisan Mahasangh. Abhimanyu ji, hamare saath judne ke liye dhanyawad. Kisanon ne kal raat ki jo protest ki thi Delhi mein. उनकी एक ये मांग भी थी कि डीजल की प्राइस कम करनी चाहिए. डीजल की प्राइस से किसानों पे क्या असर पड़ता है?
देखिए, डीजल के प्राइस बढ़ने से चार फ्रंट पे किसानों को नुकसान उठाना पड़ता है. जो पहला है उनकी कल्टीवेशन कॉस्ट, दूसरा है इरिगेशन कॉस्ट, तीसरा है ट्रांसपोर्टेशन कॉस्ट और चौथा है केमिकल फर्टिलाइजर की कॉस्ट. अगर हम कल्टीवेशन कॉस्ट की बात करें तो सभी किसानों के पास खुद के ट्रैक्टर नहीं होते हैं, इसीलिए वो ट्रैक्टर किराए पे लेते हैं किसी दूसरे किसान से और उसे कल्टीवेशन करते हैं. तो ये डीजल के प्राइस बढ़ने से पिछले एक साल में उस कल्टीवेशन कॉस्ट, जो उसका रेंट है उसका, वो 30% तक इंक्रीज हो गया है कल्टीवेशन कॉस्ट के मामले में, जो उसका रेंट है. अगर हम बात इरिगेशन कॉस्ट की करें तो लगभग हर एकड़ लैंड के ऊपर पिछले एक साल में डीजल के प्राइस बढ़ने से 2.5 से 3 हजार रुपया प्रति एकड़ होगा। जहां पे इलेक्ट्रिकल ट्यूबवेल नहीं है, जहां डीजल ट्यूबवेल्स है, वहां पे 2.5 से 3 हजार रुपए की इंक्रीमेंट हुई है। अगर हम बात ट्रांसपोर्टेशन कॉस्ट की करें तो जहां पहले पश्चिमी उत्तर प्रदेश में एक बोरी आलू को ट्रांसपोर्ट करने में जहां पे 20 रुपए का खर्चा आता है, आज उसी को ट्रांसपोर्ट करने में 30 से 35 रुपए का खर्चा आ रहा है, तो उससे उसकी इनपुट कॉस्ट लगातार बढ़ रही है। अगर आप बात केमिकल फर्टिलाइजर्स की करें तो पिछले 6 महीने में केमिकल फर्टिलाइजर की कॉस्ट 5 से लेकर 25% तक उसमें इंक्रीमेंट हुआ है। तो टोटल मिला के अगर आप इस चारों फ्रंट पे उसको जो इंक्रीमेंट हुई है आप उसको काउंट करेंगे तो टोटल जो उसकी कॉस्ट है, जो उसकी प्रोडक्शन कॉस्ट है, वो 20% इंक्रीज हुई है लास्ट एक साल में। और वही बात अगर उसको एमएसपी की जाए, जैसा आप सब जानते हैं और आपके चैनल पे कई बार डिबेट भी होती रहती है, एमएसपी में उसकी कोई भी बढ़ोतरी नहीं हुई है। तो जब उसकी इनपुट कॉस्ट लगातार इतनी बढ़ती है तो उसी का ये परिणाम आता है, जैसा हमने कल देखा। रात को इतने गुस्साए हुए किसान आए थे कि उनको उन्होंने बैरिकेड भी तोड़ दिए, उसके बाद फिर पुलिस ने उनको दमन करने की कोशिश की। तो ये चार फ्रंट पे खासकर किसानों को नुकसान होता है, कल्टीवेशन कॉस्ट, इरिगेशन कॉस्ट, ट्रांसपोर्टेशन कॉस्ट और केमिकल फर्टिलाइजेशन कॉस्ट।
Rajendra Kapoor is the president of the Delhi Goods Transport Organization. Rajendra Kapoor, what impact does this have on transporters and what is your demand at this point?
Ma'am, हमारी डिमांड मेनली यही है कि जैसा कि ट्रांसपोर्ट का, जैसा कि अभी किसान नेता ने बताया कि ट्रांसपोर्टेशन की कॉस्ट के ऊपर पूरा पूरा इफेक्ट पड़ता है। और ट्रांसपोर्टेशन डीजल के प्राइस बढ़ेंगे तो डीजल के अंदर मैंने हमेशा से हम कहते आए हैं कि 55% जो हमारी कॉस्टिंग है, जो टोटल हमारे फ्रेट की, वो डीजल की कॉस्टिंग है। तो मेरी शुरू से एक डिमांड है कि जब आपके देश के अंदर डीजल, किसान और ट्रांसपोर्टर, जब दो ऐसे एक वो बिजनेस के धड़े हैं जिसको कि आप लोग डीजल से पूरा असर पड़ता है और जिसके बिना देश की, जिसके साथ में देश की अर्थव्यवस्था पर फ़र्क पड़ता है, तो क्यों नहीं गवर्नमेंट ऐसा करती कि डीजल के ऊपर किसानों को, ट्रांसपोर्टरों को, दोनों को सब्सिडाइज रेटों पे डीजल या वो डीजल पर मुहैया कराती। अगर नहीं तो गवर्नमेंट के साथ कॉम्प्रोमाइज़ करना पड़ेगा। हम लोग कोई बदमाश तो है नहीं, हम लोग कोई तोड़फोड़ नहीं चाहते, तोड़फोड़ करेंगे तो उसमें हमारे भी घर आते हैं, हमारा भी सब कुछ आता है। हम लोग ऐसी कोई हिंसा का कोई भी काम नहीं करेंगे जिससे कि देश को नुकसान पहुँचे। लेकिन हम कंप्रोमाइज़ करेंगे, कीमत बढ़ेगी तो महंगाई बढ़ेगी। तो ये देश, ये तो सरकार को सोचना है 2019 में अगर महंगाई बढ़ने का। जैसा कि आप लोग जानते हैं, मैं दिल्ली से बिलोंग करता हूँ, दिल्ली में प्याज की कीमतों पे सरकार जा सकती है तो महंगाई के ऊपर सरकार का क्या हाल हो सकता है। बाकी हम तो पूरी तरह से अब सरकार के साथ कंप्रोमाइजिंग उसमें मोड में आ चुके हैं।
Well, I have a question for Professor Aman Agarwal, who is the economist on the panel. Professor Agarwal, here's the question. Rupee is today at 73.34. It is at an all-time low. Diesel at an all-time high. Petrol, all-time high. LPG, CNG, all-time high. The Sensex is down today 550 points. And we also understand from reports that have now come out that the tax revenues have not met the targets for the last several months. What does this mean? Does the Indian government have elbow room at all to give us relief?
No, I think the elbow room is still there with the government. It's just a question whether they really want to implement that elbow room to give relief to the people at large. And that's a big question which the government has to surface and instruct the respective departments to go forward with it. The rupee fall is not unique. If you really see most elections, whether it is this government or the previous government, 6 to 7 months prior to elections, generally we found that the rupee has always been devalued extensively, and the Reserve Bank of India has not let it stand its currency and let it devalue itself, not only to manage its own balance sheet, but also for the fundings which come from the international markets to give relief to the people at the home country. Now, the issue is that the people are not getting finances from banks and financial institutions. That is hampering the industry extensively. And the reason for that is also the fact that there is a tight control over finances of because of NPAs, which are being in rise. So the banks are in control. Not only that, there are a lot of other issues which are being tightened up by the government. And that is actually reducing the kind of revenue base which people at large would have. And we have seen a general trend of downsell which is happening. apart from the rise in the petrol prices and the rupee falling, has also had a major impact on the way economy is supposed to go. And since if there is no growth going to take place, how do you expect tax revenues to come into the exchequer's kitty? And that's which is hampering. Does the government have a control? Yes. Not only if they allow the rupee to strengthen the way it is supposed to strengthen, then you will automatically see that there will be an improvement which will take place, not only in the oil prices, but otherwise in the whole economy. Secondly, the tax revenue collection in the petrol prices, including the excise and all, is extensively high, varying between almost from state to state, between 55 to about 68% of the price which a consumer pays is nothing else but taxes. Now, the government can try and reduce that. And we have seen that whenever the international price had fallen, then they had actually not reduced it. But when it has given rise, it has been introduced. Whereas that is no correlation, because large part of the oil import by any country, including India, is done from stipulated contracts which are actually signed about 2-3 years back at about $60-$61 a barrel. So it's only a small proportion of oil consumption which we buy on a day-to-day basis from the open market, and not the larger check. Almost about 95-97% of the oil consumption is purchased in advance. Now, given that it is the oil companies which are making exorbitant revenues and causing the economy to be a failing, the big concern for the government is if they want this inflation to keep rising and let the economy suffer, and ultimately they will bear the fruits for it also. But it's a question which the government needs to face up and go forward. Just keeping the fiscal deficit and the IMF happy would not solve the problem.
Well, now, Mr. Zafar Islam, you've heard all of the opening statements. Your response as government as to why between fishermen and farmers and truck drivers and auto drivers and housewives, those voices are not enough to move the sympathy of the government?
Well, the statement you made is absolutely incorrect, because if you have noticed, the MSPs of various produce has been increased, and the cost to the impact to the government will be around 62-63,000 crore. So it's not that government's commitment towards 50% improvement in their income, the farmers' income, is something which we have been able to deliver. Having said that you're talking about the oil prices and the rupee, I think this is two important things which need to be addressed. And I think since somebody has spoken about it, about the economy and about the inflation, I think mehngai, people were talking about mehngai. Overall, if you see, the inflation is well under control. I mean, CPI is something which actually measures the prices and the impact of prices, and that is something which is well under control. Secondly, as far as the economy is concerned, it's not that we are only trying to keep IMF happy, as one of the panelists said. It's not the fact that if you understand economy, that you also understand how the situation was in 2013 and how everything has panned out now. The economy is in very sound situation now, sound footing now, which was not there, which was missing in 2013, and all the macroeconomic parameters. This is also important for us, that the growth momentum should continue, and the reforms which had to be taken, which has been taken by the government, and the positive impact of that reforms are very, 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 very much visible. Third thing, which is very important. The prices, you have to say, oil prices is not in our control. But there are some measures which government can take, and the government has taken. Like, for instance, the ECB relaxation in ECB guidelines for oil companies, because they were buying dollar. Since they have to buy dollar, obviously the pressure was on rupee. So what is the best way to that, instead of buying that, borrow dollar? So they have given flexibility and relaxation, lot of relaxation which was not there earlier. So now the oil company, instead of buying dollar from the open market, they will borrow dollar and meet their demand. So there are measures which the government of India is taking, but you also have to see how the prices is moving in the international market.
So
while the forecast is
Said Zafar Islam,
At least, at this point in time, the pressure is that in last 2 days,
when the BJP,
the prices has gone from the per dollar from 83, it has gone up to 85 and half. And that's why the rupee has actually, the pressure was on rupee.
Okay, Mr. Islam, isn't it true when the BJP was in opposition and the price of crude was at $123 a barrel, you went out onto the streets and protested? Everybody, I mean, the press has the bites, it has the visuals of BJP leaders sitting on the street with gas cylinders in front of them, riding cycles on the street, who are now active ministers. Didn't this apply then? The same argument that you're making, that these are global prices, we're doing what we can, we should be careful of all of what was the difference? What was the difference then?
The differentiating factor, Fai, at that point in time, since you understand economy, then what was the inflation at that point in time? It was in double digit. Means the prices had, of all the important, particularly I'm talking about the food items, had gone up at that time. That's why the overall inflation was in double digit. And today, you know, where is the inflation? I'm not saying that the prices of gas cylinder have gone up. It has gone up because now it has been linked to the market. Earlier, there was subsidy of 3 lakh crore of subsidy which was given by UPA. At least that money has been used for rural infrastructure. For the infrastructure which was missing.
Okay.
That road is there. How much saving they are making in their in foil consumption? That also needs to be seen.
Okay, I'll ask Abhimanyu Kohar that question. But first, Mr. Islam, I have a couple of questions for you. Is it not true in April of this year that the government of India changed the way it measures the number of highways or the kilometers of highways that are made? For our audience's benefit, this basically means that earlier, if the government made a 3-lane highway of 1 kilometer, it would be measured as 1 kilometer of highway. We now measure each lane separately. So 1 kilometer, 3-lane highway is now 3 kilometers of highway. And that is why we suddenly seem like we're building more highways than we had done earlier. Is that not true, Mr. Islam?
No, that's not correct.
There's a bite from Mr. Nitin Gadkari, Minister of Road Transport Highways, that says this is a more realistic assessment of the total length that has been constructed. It's an internationally adopted norm in countries like United States. They all follow this method of measuring highway construction. All right, I'll ask you a different question. Mr. Nitin Gadkari has also said that...
You have to see what is the per...
Mr. Nitin Gadkari has also said that his ministry has no need to raise money from the government for construction of highway. In fact, let's play that out. He said that they have a method of raising money to construct highways. There's no fund crunch within the National Highways Authority. They don't need money from the central government. Let's play that out for our audience to hear.
There's also been a question also about private participation in highways has been dropping in terms of investment. The amount of investment coming into highways has come down. How are you planning on tackling that? By how much are you having a crunch of funds right now for construction of highways?
I don't have a crunch of funds. Okay. And the first thing is, we are now every time encouraging the private sector, public sector, to participate in the infrastructure. Particularly, I want to clear it, we have hybrid NUT projects. Okay. Because we specially designed this scheme for the sector, because the sector position was not good at that time. So the scheme is 40% we are giving them grant in aid. Land acquisition, utility shifting, everything is our responsibility. And after 80% of land acquisition, we are giving the project to the contractor. Then in the contract, he gets 15 to 20% profit. And when he complete the project, toll will be collected by the government. And we will return his money back 10 years, 12 years with adding 3% interest.
So, Mr. Zafar Islam, to tackle your first point on highways, first of all, the manner in which we're measuring highways has changed. Secondly, the minister himself says that they have a method of raising private participation. So, where is the money going then? And why does the government keep telling us that you're using the money to build highways?
No. So you have to understand two things. How much highways per day we were building in 2000 during UPA time is 12 kilometer a day, which has gone up to 27 kilometer a day.
Mr. Islam, if you count every lane, it will go up 3x, is what I just explained. You're now counting each lane instead of counting the full highway. That's the difference.
Secondly, Faye, in terms of the, if you see the budgetary allocation for the rural infrastructure, the rural road infrastructure, villages connected with the road, that's something which has never been done in the past. So fuel consumption from going one place to another has come down significantly because you have a road there.
Okay. Now let me just point out to you, this is the rural road scorecard. I have data from the government. Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana, this is from the Press Information Bureau. In 2008, 52,000 kilometers of road. In 2009, 60. 2010, 45. 2011, 30. 2012, 24. 2013, 25. 2014, 36. 2015, 36,000. 2016, 47,350. Technically, this is not a lot higher than what it was earlier. And these are numbers from the Press Information Bureau. But let me ask the question of Abhimanyu Kohar. Abhimanyu Kohar, Mr. Zafar Islam ka ye kehna hai ki government ne rural infrastructure raaste banaye aur itne acche acche raaston pe aap jo gaadiyan chalate hain gaon se, to aapki fuel ki to bachat hogi. Aap iske bare mein baat kyun nahi kar rahe?
देखिए, सबसे पहले मैं जफर इस्लाम साहब को ये बताना चाहूँगा कि हम बार बार इस चीज़ पे डिबेट भी कर चुके हैं कि बीजेपी ने चुनाव से पहले ये कहा था कि हम स्वामीनाथन कमीशन की रिपोर्ट के आधार पे एमएसपी बढ़ाएंगे और उसमें लिखा हुआ है कि C2 इन्वेस्टमेंट कॉस्ट पे 50% जोड़ के देना है, लेकिन इन्होंने जो बढ़ाए हैं वो A2+FL पे बढ़ाए हैं। इस चीज़ के बारे में हम कई बार डिस्कशन कर चुके हैं, लेकिन मुझे हैरानी होती है, और ये बात जफर इस्लाम साहब को भी पता है, लेकिन मुझे हैरानी होती है देख के कि सारी चीज़ें मालूम होते हुए भी ये कितने कॉन्फिडेंस के साथ झूठ बोलते हैं। ये एक नेशनल टीवी पे बैठ के ये इतने कॉन्फिडेंस के साथ झूठ बोल रहे हैं, ये देख के मुझे बड़ी हैरानी होती है। और दूसरी चीज़ है, देखिए जो किसान है, जब तक उसकी आप इनपुट कॉस्ट नहीं बढ़ाएंगे, वो ट्रैक्टर लेके सड़क पे तो चलता नहीं है, उसका ट्रैक्टर खेत में चलता है उसका ट्रैक्टर। और जहां पे आप बात कर रहे हैं, आप कहते हैं कि भाई आपने गरीबों के लिए, दलितों के लिए, आदिवासियों के लिए इतना किया, अरे भाई रोड पे तो गाड़ी में बैठ के वो जब जाएगा जब आप उसकी 3 वक्त की रोटी का इंतजाम करेंगे। लेकिन आपने महंगाई इतनी ज्यादा कर दी है कि उसकी 3 वक्त की रोटी का इंतजाम नहीं हो पा रहा है। आज मैं ग्वालियर से आ रहा हूं और ग्वालियर में 25,000 गरीब आदिवासी भूमिहीन किसान इकट्ठा होकर बैठे हैं और एकता परिषद के बैनर तले वो दिल्ली तक का मार्च कर रहे हैं। इससे पहले 2 बार भी वो मार्च कर चुके हैं, लेकिन उनको कोई भी, किसी भी सरकार ने, किसी भी पार्टी की सरकार रही हो, उनके लिए कुछ नहीं किया है। उनके लिए पहले आप उनकी जो मूलभूत सुविधाएं हैं, पहले आप उनकी वो सुनिश्चित कीजिए, उनको 3 वक्त की रोटी, उनके सर के ऊपर छत और उनको कपड़े की मूलभूत सुविधाएं उपलब्ध करवाइए, उसके बाद आप ये इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर की बात कीजिए। इस देश की बड़ी पॉपुलेशन का एक बड़ा जो हिस्सा है वो आज भी इन सभी रोड से और बाकी चीजों से कटा हुआ है, पहले आप उसके लिए मूलभूत सुविधा उपलब्ध करवाइए सर।
एक मिनट, राजेंद्र कपूर, प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ दिल्ली गुड्स ट्रांसपोर्ट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, गिव अस अ टेस्टिमनी ऑन द हाईवेज एंड देन मिस्टर इस्लाम कैन रिस्पॉन्ड टू बोथ ऑफ यू। मिस्टर राजेंद्र कपूर, इफ द हाईवेज हैव बीन बिल्ट व्हिच शुड मेक लाइफ इजियर फॉर द ट्रांसपोर्टर्स, व्हाई आर यू स्टिल कंप्लेनिंग?
हाईवेज, बिल्कुल हाईवेज के ऊपर जरूर काम हुआ है, लेकिन जैसा कि मंत्री जी ने कहा कि हाईवेज के लिए हमें पैसे की जरूरत नहीं है, लेकिन हाईवेज के जो एडजॉइनिंग रोड्स हैं उनके ऊपर काम नहीं हुआ है। बीजेपी के जो प्रवक्ता हैं वो बिल्कुल गलत बोल रहे हैं। और एक बात जिससे मैं कहना चाहता हूँ, जो पहले बीजेपी के प्रवक्ता साहब ने बोली कि जो ये पेट्रोल डीजल के दाम हमारे हाथ में नहीं है, हमारी सरकार के हाथ में नहीं है, मैं याद दिलाना चाहता हूँ कि जब कर्नाटका में इलेक्शन थे तो 19 दिन 1 रुपया भी ना रेट बढ़ा, ना 1 पैसा ना रेट घटा ना बढ़ा। तो अब उसके बाद से डेली रेट कभी बढ़ रहा है। तो उस दिनों अगर बीजेपी, अगर सरकार के हाथ में ये चीज़ नहीं थी तो सरकार ने, ये कैसे कह रहे बीजेपी के प्रवक्ता कि हमारे हाथ में ये चीज़ नहीं है कि पेट्रोल के दाम या डीजल के दाम हमारे हाथ में नहीं है? तो उन 19 दिनों में ऐसा क्या हुआ कि उस 19 दिनों में बिल्कुल दाम नहीं बढ़ाए गए ना घटाए गए?
Mr. Islam, do you want to respond to that? I bring in Gautam Mukherjee. Zafar Islam, rebuttal please. Go ahead.
मैं इस पे 2-3 बातें कहना चाहता हूँ, इनके याद दिलाना चाहता हूँ कि देखिए, अगर आप देखेंगे कि पेट्रोल डीजल के दाम, मैं ये कह रहा हूँ कि पेट्रोल डीजल के दाम जब घटे थे तो उतना नहीं घटाया गया था जितने इंटरनेशनल प्राइसेस बढ़े घटे थे। आज जितना बढ़े हैं उतना नहीं बढ़ाया गया। अगर आप छोटी सी चीज़ को कैलकुलेट करेंगे तो जनवरी 2016 में प्राइस देखिए, जो उस वक्त था $28 a barrel था, आज ये है आज आज के इस वक्त जब हम बात कर रहे हैं $85 है बैरल हो गया है, आप देखिए परसेंटेज कितना 28 से जो है वो कितना परसेंट बढ़ गया।
नहीं, इस्लाम आप गलत कैलकुलेशन दे रहे हो,
कभी भी नहीं रहा।
लेट मी जस्ट, नो नो, वन सेकंड, लेट मी जस्ट आस्क माय टीम, डू यू हैव द क्रूड चार्ट ऑफ वेयर क्रूड वाज? वी विल जस्ट पुल दैट अप। मिस्टर इस्लाम, crude was at $120 a barrel, at which point we were paying about 65 rupees for petrol. Crude then came down to $30 a barrel and you didn't give us that cut. We continued to pay 65 rupees for petrol and then it started to move up again and you've moved up with it. So it is unfair. I just want to correct what you're saying. What you're saying is unfair.
No, you said... No, absolutely not. I think you didn't allow me to complete. I said that when the prices came off, we didn't pass on the entire benefit to the consumer.
Yes, you didn't.
We saved definitely some amount because the oil bond pay karna tha plus aur bhi
oil bonds to apne pay nahi kiye sir. Aur bhi
garibon ke liye.
Nein, Zafar Islam ji, main to rebut karungi. Aapne oil bonds nahi pay kiye, aapne oil bonds ki bas interest payment kiya hai ab tak.
Sun lijiye, puri baat sunke baad rebut kijiye to acha lagega.
Ji, boliye aap.
Nein, aap acha lagega puri baat sunke.
Boliye.
Jab main keh raha hu ki us waqt saving thi, aaj aap bataiye ki jab aap chhota sa calculation kijiye na, $28 tha. $28 था कि नहीं जनवरी 2016 में? अभी आप राजेंद्र जी कह रहे हैं $28 नहीं था, ये तो गलत बात है भाई, आप जाके डेटा देखिए। और उस वक्त से अभी बढ़ के कितना हो गया, अभी जब बात कर रहे हैं $85 हो गया है, तो कितना परसेंटेज बढ़ा आप खुद देख लीजिए। और अगर 28 उस वक्त जब जनवरी 2016 में 60 रुपए दिल्ली में पेट्रोल था, आज कितना है वो परसेंटेज इंक्रीज देखिए।
जो आप लोगों ने 12 लाख करोड़ रुपए कमाया है, उस पैसे का आपने क्या किया?
बढ़ा तो कंज्यूमर को 30-40% प्राइस बढ़ा।
नहीं, दैट्स अनफेयर। इनफैक्ट वी स्टिल लुकिंग फॉर दैट चार्ट, आई वांट टू पुट इट अप एज सून एज आई कैन, बट फर्स्ट गौतम मुखर्जी द इकोनॉमिस्ट विल रिस्पोंड। गौतम मुखर्जी, कंप्लीटली अनफेयर कैलकुलेशन। आई एम सॉरी मिस्टर इस्लाम, आई अलाउड यू टू फिनिश। Completely unfair calculation. Yeah. The government made 12 lakh crore rupees. That's my money. Where is it? Gautam Mukherjee, go ahead, please. Gautam Mukherjee.
No. We can bandy statistics, but the fact is that the central government increased excise 9 times between 2014 and now, and reduced it only once. The states have bettered that by far, by running it anywhere between 25% and 40% additional taxes. And these taxes, you know, are, you know, forever growing, and it's an easy way to collect these taxes because everybody is held to hostage and nobody has done anything in response to the public agony of these prices rising at the rate of 20 paisa, 30 paisa on a daily basis. And to say inflation is under control is very, very temporary as a outlook, because if your petrol is going to cost you so much, other things are bound to go up. It's only a matter of time. It won't be just the fiscal deficit and the current account deficit. It will be rampant retail inflation for all of us. What yes. business has the government got to charge us 70%, 100% taxes?
And here's my question to Professor Aman Agarwal, who's the economist as well on the panel. Professor Agarwal, when inflation goes up, the RBI increases interest rates, because that's the way to control inflation. The RBI has increased interest rates twice already without inflation going up. Why has the RBI increased interest rates? Because it's controlling the inflation before we can even see it. Professor Agarwal.
That's right.
You're quite right, but the RBI also looks at what is going on in the international market. And since the United States, which has been one of the key indicators for the way of movements going on in terms of interest is going up or going down, has been followed by RBI even before. This time, since the US had already done it about 3 or 4 times, so it was impudent that they also look at it going up. Then in any case, you rightly said that the expectations which were there of inflationary pressures coming up is another reason why they have actually made it go up. The other component is that they wanted certain deposits to come in for people to bring in the money back into the accounts and not do that spending which goes on.
But here's my question, Professor Agarwal, where is the inflation? Now, we've all learned in economics class that when diesel and petrol goes up, everything becomes more expensive. We're expecting that would happen. But as Mr. Islam has said, the inflation number has stayed low. How is that possible?
Yes, you see, inflation as a statistics measure is always played by various governments and has been played by India, even in the United States, by changing the measure from something called a regular inflation and a core inflation. A core inflation actually excludes food and oil. And that is, these are the two components which actually make inflation bubble up. The other components actually bubble up after almost a decade's period when the inflation has impacted them. And this is where most governments play with the word inflation, because you and me, when we talk of it, we look at that figure, which is inflation. We have to look at the fine prints, whether we are reading inflation as a full basket of goods, or are we reading it only as core inflation, which excludes oil and food prices. And this is and the other thing is, in India, though we have moved to the CPI index, but we still have large amount of commodities which are based on the WPI index, and which has been traditionally been running this country for the last 70 years. So just talking of CPI and CPI and calibrating CPI would not help, because large part of the formal market where the food grains and other things comes into play, even including the oil, is based on the WPI. So yes, we need to look at that inflation factor and not the other inflation factor.
One point
I would like to make, which
ahead.
Is not being mentioned here, is that we have foreign exchange reserves worth $420 billion, anywhere between $400 to $420 billion. Mm. Why are we sitting on those reserves? What are we having those reserves for? Any saving which a person has is to take care of any difficulty which one faces. And, you know, that difficulty is today. The government clearly sees that people at large are in problem. Why are they not using those reserves to provide ease to the people, instead of taxing them with more and more burdens on a day-to-day basis, which is going to be a big cost for this government, which they are not able to appreciate in the long run.
But I have a question for Abhimanyu Kohar. Abhimanyu ji, aapne kaha ki aapke ki kisanon ke liye mehngai badh gayi hai. Zafar Islam ji keh rahe hain ki mehngai to badhi hi nahi, ki inflation ka jo number hai abhi bhi kam hai. To aap kis mehngai ke bare mein baat kar rahe hain?
देखिए, जफर इस्लाम साहब आंकड़ों के साथ उनका खेल कर रहे हैं, आंकड़ों का खेल कर रहे हैं. अगर आप जाके देखेंगे जो प्याज के दाम थे मंडी में, जो आलू के दाम थे, जो सब्जियों के दाम थे, आप अगर एक साल पहले का देखेंगे और आज का देखेंगे, उनमें जमीन आसमान का अंतर है. आप किसी भी चीज़ में देख लीजिए, जब आप ग्राउंड पे जाते हैं तो उसमें बहुत सारी महंगाई बढ़ी है. और जहाँ तक बात, अगर उसमें एक सार्थक तरीके से सुझाव देने की अगर हम बात करें, तो इससे पहले क्या होता था, पहले वाली सरकारों ने भी एक एक्सपेरिमेंट किया था कि ईरान के साथ जो हम तेल खरीदते थे उसके बदले में हम चावल या गेहूँ उनको देते थे, तो इससे जो हमारे देश के किसान थे उनको एक बड़ा मार्केट भी मिल जाता था गेहूँ और चावल का. लेकिन आज के दिन सरकार ने उस पर पूरा बैन लगा रखा है. सरकार अमेरिका के दबाव में आके ना तो ईरान से तेल इंपोर्ट कर रही है और ना ही वहां पे गेहूं और चावल भेजने की अनुमति दे रही है. तो सरकार अगर एक पॉलिटिकल विल पावर के साथ अगर काम करे, तो ये सारी चीजें कंट्रोल करना कोई बड़ा कोई वो सवाल, कोई बड़ा मसला नहीं है. और मैम देखिए, जो ये कह रहे हैं जफर इस्लाम साहब कि भाई हमने इतना सेविंग किया, इतना हमने दलितों के लिए किया, इतना गरीबों के लिए, कितना इतना आदिवासियों के लिए किया, जफर इस्लाम साहब आप ग्राउंड पे जाके देखिए. मध्य प्रदेश में एक क्षेत्र है छिंदवाड़ा, वहां पे आदिवासी अपनी किडनियां, अपनी आंख बेचने के लिए मजबूर हैं, और वो किडनियां और आंख बेच के अपनी तीन वक्त की रोटी का इंतजाम कर रहे हैं. अगर हम इन एसी के बंद कमरों से बाहर निकलें और इस देश के जो 52 करोड़ लोग जो किसानी पे डायरेक्टली या इनडायरेक्टली डिपेंडेंट हैं, अगर उनके घर में जाके अगर हम देखें, तो आपको फिर मालूम चलेगा कि महंगाई बढ़ी है या महंगाई नहीं बढ़ी है.
ज़फ़र इस्लाम जी, आई हैव अ क्वेश्चन फॉर यू. When Mr. Arun Jaitley, the current finance minister, was in opposition, he did an interview with NDTV, the television channel, and he said this, and I'm quoting what he has said: if crude price falls to $90 a barrel, there is no reason why petrol should be more than 50 rupees. Crude is currently at 80 rupees, petrol is at 90 rupees. Ye calculation mein galti ho gayi? Kya hua, Mr. Islam?
देखिए, जहां तक पहले मैं अभिमन्यु जी का जवाब देता हूं
जी.
कि देखिए, आप जमीनी हालत के बारे में जो कह रहे हैं, यही सरकार है जो गरीबों के बारे में ध्यान करती है. और आप किसी भी वेलफेयर स्कीम के बारे में देखिए, तो आपको आप एक चीज को लेके मत चलिए कि सिर्फ एक हेडलाइन नंबर देख रहे हैं. ओवरऑल सरकार ने जो किया है गरीबों के लिए, उसके बारे में कीजिए. दूसरी बात मैं कहना चाहता हूं
कि जहां तक आपने बोला कि बास्केट के बारे में अग्रवाल साहब बात कर रहे थे
जी,
भाई बास्केट में अभी सीपीआई में क्या फूड इन्फ्लेशन नहीं है? बास्केट उसका वेट्स कितना है? 46% वेट है फूड का, फूड बास्केट में अब, और ऑयल का 10% तक कम है। कास्केडिंग इफेक्ट लगाइएगा तो भी उसमें फूड के इस पर आता है। तो ऐसा नहीं कि सीपीआई जो है वो जो जमीनी हकीकत उससे दूर है। WPI बताते हैं, CPI इज द राइट पैरामीटर टू जज के कहाँ कहाँ पर प्राइस बढ़ा है नहीं बढ़ा है, और पहले भी इसी तरह से देखा जाता था। जहाँ तक जो आज के दिन में है फूड, जैसे आपने कहा किसी चीज़ के दाम हो सकते बढ़े हो, लेकिन कई चीज़ों के दाम घटे। क्या दाल के दाम नहीं घटे हैं? क्या फ्रूट्स के दाम नहीं घटे हैं? क्या सब्जियों के दाम घटे नहीं है? कुछ चीजों के दाम बढ़े भी होंगे, लेकिन बास्केट का तो ये मतलब है कि पूरे ओवरऑल जो इंपैक्ट है सबके वेट्स असाइन किए हुए हैं और फूड का सबसे बड़ा वेट है।
बट मिस्टर इस्लाम, बढ़ा के घटाने में क्या फायदा? तो और बेस सरकार बेस जो है वो बेस ईयर का कैलकुलेशन आप लोगों ने दो तीन अग्रवाल साहब सोच रहे हैं, ऐसा
एक इकोनॉमिस्ट ऐसा सोच रहे हैं तो एक दूसरा मापदंड लेके आया जाए। अग्रवाल साहब की सोच ऐसी है, सरकार को पूरा मापदंड चेंज कर देना चाहिए। जहां तक आप देखिए, गरीबों के लिए हमने खर्च किया, अभी जो भी हमने स्कीम लेके आए उनके हॉस्पिटलाइजेशन का, वो इस तरह से किसने सोचा था गरीबों के लिए? आज तक किसी ने नहीं सोचा था। आप देखिए, अगर आप दूसरी घर घर तक बिजली पहुंचाने का जरूरत की जो कोशिश थी,
एक मिनट मिस्टर इस्लाम, घर घर तक बिजली पहुंचाने की स्टैटिस्टिक्स है मेरे पास, मैं पढूं?
ट्रैक्टर सेल्स देखिए, टू व्हीलर सेल्स देखिए, कार सेल्स देखिए, सब गांव में तो सेल हो रहा है।
मिस्टर मिस्टर जाफर इस्लाम, रूरल इलेक्ट्रिफिकेशन कॉर्पोरेशन के आंकड़े हैं मेरे पास में, मैं पढूं?
जो है भी मोटरसाइकिल का गांव से।
अच्छा, आई विल टेक दैट एज अ यस। नाउ अकॉर्डिंग टू द रूरल इलेक्ट्रिफिकेशन कॉर्पोरेशन ऑफ इंडिया, दिस इज द इलेक्ट्रिफिकेशन डेटा। नाउ लेट्स गो एज फार बैक एज 2007-08, एंड दिस इज इलेक्ट्रिफिकेशन ऑफ अनइलेक्ट्रिफाइड विलेजेस। सो इन दैट ईयर we did 9,300 villages, after which we did 12,000 villages, 18,000 villages in the year 2009-10, 18,000 in 10-11, 7,934 in 11-12. It dropped in the year 2012-13 to 2,000, after that 1,100, 1,400. In the year 2015-16, it came back up to 7,000, and 16-17 to 6,000. So agreed that we have managed to achieve a goal, but we've achieved it because we've been working at it for the last 20 years. I also have data of households specifically. Again, the data of households specifically has not changed very drastically in the last 10 years. There has been a period between 2012-13 and 13-14 where the number dropped, but otherwise, it's not different from what it was 10 years ago. Now, Mr. Islam, you talked about projects that the government has done. I've got data on every single project today. My research team has done a fantastic job. Please tell me, which project do you want to talk about?
No, see, for instance, let's take one example. How much we saved in direct benefit transfer? How much leakages earlier were there and how much we have saved? This government has saved.
How many
schemes where the money was earlier not transferred through directly in the bank, now is being transferred directly in the beneficiary's bank account, and how much saving and how the common man.
So what have you done with that money?
Why don't you highlight this also?
So what have you
and
done with that
money? Who
has taken
this initiative?
Let's talk about savings. Now, in the tax that you have collected from the citizens of India through petrol and diesel alone, you've collected 12 lakh crore rupees in the last 4 years. I'm not even counting the latest, 12 lakh crore rupees. You talked specifically about the oil bonds that were given out by the UPA government. Now, the oil bonds have not been paid out. And even if you did pay them out, you've only paid the interest. But even if you did pay it out, that's 1 lakh crore rupees. What happened to the remaining 11 lakh crore rupees, Mr. Islam? Since we're talking about savings and you're saying that the government has money to give us a tax cut today, where did the money go?
Fine. Well, let me ask you one question. Since all the economists and
am I asking the questions or are you asking the questions? Okay, go ahead.
No. I'm asking a counter question to you. And the
you haven't given me my answer first.
Professor Agarwal, both are there.
Okay, go ahead.
No. The question is my answer.
Okay, you're going to answer a question with a question.
What is the size of the budget? And how much is the and what is government has the ability to maneuver? How much is left for the government to maneuver? You also have to take that into account.
How much government is left for the government to maneuver? 11 lakh crore rupees is left for the government. Simple mathematics.
53% is already committed. So government has only...
No, but you have no business committing this money. This money was never yours.
And that is the flexibility government has.
No, Mr. Islam, you have no business committing this money. This money was never yours. You can't possibly say you spent it. Aapne kharch kaise ki, ye to aapke paise hi nahi hai. But anyone on the panel who wants to answer this question, whether it's Gautam Mukherjee or Professor Agarwal.
Aapke jo 12 lakh crore ka number hi main agree nahi karta hu. On what basis you are calculating? First year you can make the benefit. How can you continuously make the same benefit?
No. Any economist, please back me up here.
If I'm asking a simple question. First year, when the prices have dropped.
If you use money taken for one purpose to cross-subsidize something else. And this is a continuous process that most governments get up to. And then say, you see, my pockets are empty because I've used your petrol cess on something else. That's what's going on. And to say that this is... Look, when Mr. Modi came to the public and said, I'm going to take out the subsidies and charge you according to international prices, at that time itself, because of what the UPA government had done, we were already in a solid surplus even after paying the subsidies. Now what happened is the subsidies come off. In other words, the public gets hit with the subsidies that are no longer being given to them, plus the profit they were making on the taxes that were already in place during UPA have been raised a further 9 times. And everybody's silent on it, and they talk of GST. Now look, the states are profiteering as much, if not more, than the center, I grant you. But the fact is, this is not fair to the public. And to say, you know, I can't help it because my budgets are not in order, is not answering the question. It is evading it. And to say it is not inflationary is nonsense.
One basic question, Faye.
One second, Mr. Islam, it's my job to ask the questions. It's your job to answer the questions. Aap sawal pe sawal puche ja rahe ho. Jawab kaun dega?
No.
What do you mean why?
You said 12 lakh crore.
What do you mean why?
Tell me, why did you give a breakup each year? How much the government has
done? Again, Mr. Islam, to be fair, it is not my job to give a breakup of tax collections. It is your job. But Mr. Aman Agarwal, now here's where the calculation comes.
Prices, when the prices dropped only once, How can you
the prices didn't drop only once.
I don't understand.
Okay, let me explain. I'll explain to Mr. Islam.
When you talk of 2016, those prices were much higher than the international prices.
I'll explain to Mr. Islam and then we'll open this up again. Mr. Islam.
Come on.
Mr. Islam. Price of crude used to be 120. Aap sunne rahe ho mere explanation, Mr. Islam.
No,
I'm explaining. You're not listening to me. Mr. Islam. The price of crude used to be $120 a barrel, at which point we were paying 65 rupees for petrol. The difference at that point was coming out of the central government. The central government was making up the difference through what you're calling oil bonds, taking the hit themselves and actually giving us a discount. The price of crude then crashed after your government, and this was good fortune and good vastu for your government, that from $120 a barrel when the BJP government took over, it dropped to $30 a barrel. But we continued, so here,
they were saving?
Yes, hang on. So we continued to pay 65 rupees for petrol because the government then took the margin and pocketed that margin, which is fair. You're allowed to do that. This situation continued for 3 years. It went from 30 to 40, from 40 to $50 a barrel. Still sharply lower than the 120 we were paying at one point. The government made a constant profit on petrol for 4 years. Now that four-year profit calculated over the last period of 4 years is coming up to 12 lakh crore rupees.
We have a disconnect here.
Okay, we do we? Go ahead.
We have a complete disconnect here.
Go ahead, please.
First year, when the prices have come off, you made a saving. I agree with you. The saving is there, 2,73,000 crore. Now they tell me how every year the same profit you will make when the prices have already come off.
There's still a difference, Mr. Islam. Your calculation is wrong.
One time I agree.
There's still a difference. Come off, even make, today, you're making saving. A profit.
Every year,
still a difference.
You are in power.
Mr. Islam seems to. Mr. Islam, I'll give you some time to check the math on this, but Rajendra Kapoor has a point to make. You are still making, just to make it very clear for our audience, the government, central government, makes 20 rupees per litre. I'm answering the question. The central government makes 20 rupees per litre of petrol. So if you're paying 80 rupees for petrol, 20 rupees out of that goes to the central government. 40, so 45 rupees is actual petrol. No. The remaining is all tax. That's how you're making money. Now, Rajendra Kapoor has a point to make. Mr. Kapoor, go ahead. Mr. Kapoor, go ahead.
केंद्र सरकार राज्यों को कम से कम जब ये बैरल क्रूड ऑयल के रेट बढ़े हुए हैं उस समय पर आदेश जारी कर सके एक मिनट इस्लाम साहब आप आदेश जारी कर सकते हैं केंद्र से राज्यों को कि जब तक क्रूड ऑयल के रेट बढ़े हुए हैं आप अपने टैक्सेस कम करें जब क्रूड ऑयल के रेट घटेंगे तब आप बढ़ा लीजिएगा अपने टैक्सेस
इनफैक्ट
इसको किसी तरह तो आप बैलेंस कीजिए पेट्रोल और डीजल के दामों को कहीं ना कहीं तो आप बैलेंस करेंगे
Let's put that chart up on the screen one more time and this is the, give me the breakup of petrol in Delhi, please. Total price down to what it actually costs. Tel Delhi mein jo bikti hai, abhi 80 rupay ki hoti hai. Just go, there you have it, 83 rupees for petrol in Delhi. And you'll see that breakup. Now the price charged to the dealer, so after it has been refined, margin done, it's come to the dealer. From the dealer, it is 42 rupees 79 paise a litre. From 42 rupees to 83 rupees, all taxes. Excise duty, 20 rupees. That's the money going to the central government. Dealer commission, 3.66 rupees per litre. VAT is what the state government charges you, 17 rupees 80 paise. So the central government is making 20 rupees a litre on petrol. We have a similar breakup for diesel. We'll put that up as well. Let's put up diesel so that we can take a look. There it is. So that's your diesel breakup. Diesel in Delhi, 75 rupees and 9 paise. It's only 46 rupees actually. Excise duty, 15 rupees 33 paise. That is the profit being made by the government of India on petrol and diesel. Now, off this tax, Mr. Zafar Islam, year after year, without showing any sort of sympathy to the citizen, you've continued to collect this tax. That's how your 2.5 lakh crore rupees has become 12 lakh crore rupees.
Faye, how can you make that statement? No. Don't give a statistic without justification. I'm asking a counter question because I feel that you are propagating something which is incorrect.
Okay, go ahead. Ask me counter questions. Today, I will play government.
Government expenditure is known to you. Where the budgetary allocation has been made is known to you. My question, simple question is to you, when the prices is going up, the government is passing on the entire burden to the consumer? It's a simple question.
Yes.
No, it is not the case.
It
the
is
government,
the case.
Whatever government has saved, part of that is being part of.
Aman Agarwal will answer. No, but you've not cut the prices. You've increased
if the
it nine times.
You've only decreased it once.
Professor Aman Agarwal, very quickly before I run out of time, Professor Agarwal, go ahead.
Two points here. Firstly, the fiscal deficit has been fairly under good control, and we have a buffer of almost 100 basis point there. Even Rajiv Kumar from Niti Aayog says this quite abruptly. Secondly, Mrs. Zafar says from $28 to about $85 a barrel or so. Please understand, sir, you have been a banker yourself. And you know very well, most of these large products are contained in forward contracts, which are signed by governments internationally for a long term, which has now skewed down to about 3 to 4 years, which is considered to be long term now. Now that petrol was already bought. As I said, 90 to 95% of our daily needs are bought in advance and contracts are signed in advance at a barrel rate of between $50 a barrel to about $62 a barrel about 3 years back. Now, given that, and this fluctuation of price is only for about 2 to about 8% of the petrol which we require every day. Any petrol which you buy today is not going to come to our market today. It will have to be shipped by whichever company does, and it will take about a month, 2 months. How are you charging that price to us today for a whole lot of petrol which we are buying today or diesel? Please explain me as a banker who has served in banking industry for such a long time.
Mr. Islam, go ahead, please. I have 3 minutes.
Mr. Agarwal, the prices, it is like whatever the price which is currently ruling in the market, you don't see the same price It is not being passed on immediately. It comes with a lag, as you rightly mentioned.
Sir, if the oil is purchased from open market,
if the prices in the national market is going up every day, it does not go up. It does not reflect immediately. As you rightly mentioned, it does not reflect immediately. It comes with a lag, and lag can be 30 days or 15 days or whatever.
All right, I've run out of time. I've run out of time on this discussion, but obviously the discussion is not over. We will keep coming back to it.
Even today.
Just to give you an update of the discoveries that we have made. The government tells us that we are building highways with this money. We've discovered that as of April this year, the government of India changed the measure in which highways are being calculated. So earlier you would build a highway and say this is 1 kilometer of highway. Now they're counting each lane separately. So it's now, if it's four lanes in the highway, you've built 4 kilometers of highway. So automatically the calculation of how many highways, how much we've built in terms of highways has gone up. And this is available on the internet. You can check it out for yourself if you want to. That's the first point. The second point is that we've had the Union Minister of Surface Transport tell us that they have toll income coming in. They bring in partners on private sector to build highways. So they don't need as much money from the government. They use investments instead. So where is the money going? It boils down to simply this. Fuel is at an all-time high. LPG is at an all-time high. CNG is at an all-time high. The rupee is at an all-time low. The market is crashing. Now, there has to be some relief offered. The government is focused at this point in maintaining its own savings. And its savings are in the fiscal deficit and the foreign exchange reserves. And it's great that you want to maintain those savings. But the whole point of making a saving is that you use it in tough times. These are tough times. Expecting citizens to pay 93 rupees for petrol and 85 rupees for diesel is unfair. These are the tough times when you need to offer cuts. 900 rupees for a gas cylinder is unfair. And this is just the middle class speaking. We're not even talking about, like Abhimanyu Kohar was telling us, what's happening to the people in rural India who are barely able to put food on the table. How are we going to justify allowing citizens to starve to death in a country like ours? We cannot possibly be living in a country where people are starving. We have to be able to feed every single Indian. Cooking gas is a good way to start. We're going to continue to demand accountability from the government. The Ujjwala Yojana that we're talking about, where you tell us that you have distributed gas cylinders to crores of women, that's fantastic. How are they going to refill that gas cylinder next month at 900 rupees or 500 rupees for a subsidized cylinder? They can't afford it. You're telling me you went into below poverty line homes and gave them gas cylinders and gas connections. That's fantastic. What are they going to do when the cylinder runs out? How will they pay for it? How will they ever be able to use it? These are questions we must answer. Remember that the gas cylinder is how we feed our families. There's no way around it. There has to be a tax cut. The government has to stop at this point profiteering from fuel. Thanks for watching.